Okay, friends, I'm very glad that Erika invited me after our ITC conference where we worked together and where we talked about the seven jewels of wisdom. The seven jewels of wisdom is nothing new. I have the feeling that you all know them, but it gives a totally new viewpoint on your study of theosophy. At least I hope it does that. To really understand that, I have to dive into history first. In 1888, Blavatsky, Helena Petrovna Blavatsky, wrote her Secret Doctrine. And I think there's none of you who has not studied that source of wisdom. And 30, 40 years later, in 1924, Catherine Tingley and Godfried de Peruyker in Point Loma started a study group studying the secret doctrine. And what they did was, in the first 15 meetings of that series of 50 study evenings, they started to present the seven jewels of wisdom. And why was that? We all know that the secret doctrine is notorious of for its lack of system. And Helena Blavatsky did that on purpose to accentuate, to awaken our Buddhic insight and not our intellectual habit of making rows of subjects and so on. You know the difference. And what Catherine Tingley and Godfried de Peruyker did was giving at least a little bit of structure in our study of the secret doctrine. And they called it the seven jewels, the Sapta Ratnani in Sanskrit. Blavatsky never made that system so clear on purpose, as I hope I explained that to you now. And you find in the secret doctrine that she really knew what it was. And I show you a part. Of the text. I can read it out loud. You can read it as well. As it is above, so is it below, is the fundamental axiom of occult philosophy. And there it comes. As the logos is sevenfold, that means throughout cosmos, it appears as seven logoi under seven different forms, or as taught by the learned Brahmins. Each of these is the central figure of one of the seven main branches of the ancient wisdom religion. So, when she wrote that in the Secret Doctrine, that is for us proof that she knew that she could divide into a structure seven main branches of theosophy. And she never, how do you say that, explains further in the secret doctrine. She gives three hints, and I show them to you. She said it is more difficult, however, to explain it in a few words or even lines from the standpoint of occult science and symbolism. In other words, those seven branches as sevenfold are not so much talked about because it touches the esoteric side of theosophy. But she gives three hints. In Hinduism, you find the 14 precious things. In Taoism, you see the seven jewels. And in Japanese Buddhism, you find the seven precious things. You see, she talks about it without explaining. And in 1924, Godfried de Brugge started to explain it more. Not all. And even tonight with this lecture, you cannot expect me to give all. It is impossible, for it goes deeper and deeper and deeper into, in fact, infinity. What does he say? The ancient wisdom tells us that there are seven doctrinal keys to wisdom and future initiations. And now you understand why she doesn't talk so much about it. These seven keys, the ancients called the Saptaratnani, the seven jewels or gems or treasures. And I really want to introduce to you those seven laws of nature. I give you an overview. You see, and I start in the under part, the lower part of this page, because we go higher and higher. The law of reincarnation. You all know reincarnation. The second is the law of karma. You all know karma. And then the third is the hierarchical structure of the universe. And then the fourth is svabhava, self-becoming. The fifth is self-directed evolution. The sixth is the two paths, the Amrita and Prajekayana, you all know that. And the seventh is Atmavidya, knowledge of the self. And I have the feeling that I did not tell any of you something new. You all know these teachings in theosophy, but the difference is that Godfried de Brugge put them in perspective, made them interrelated to each other. And that is some very helpful thing in your study. And I'm glad that Erika asked me to tell you more about that. And there's one thing what you know already as well, and especially because I understood that Erika is giving lectures about the voice of the silence. And I don't know whether you already came to the third fragment of the voice, where the seven paramitas are explained by HPB. And Godfried de Brugge taught us one thing, that the seven jewels of wisdom, the seven teachings about the seven key teachings in theosophy can never be understood when you do not practice the seven paramitas. That is a one-to-one combination. And I hope to be able to explain that tonight. In the second fragment of the Voice of the Silence, Blavatsky says, the first step is to choose in your life for compassion, for the path of renunciation, to live for humanity instead of only for yourself. And that is the first step. And only after that choice, it is a good thing and can be successful to study the seven paramitas. If you do not choose for compassion, you can study the paramitas, but they will never be part of your character. For the paramitas are the transcendental virtues. And that means that when you really live along those paramitas, your character is changed. your character spiritualizes. Your character becomes more spiritual. And that is exactly what you need when you want to walk the path of compassion. So we make a combination. And before I do that, I, as a reminder, give you the seven names of the paramitas. Do not look at the right part, all those letters, we come to there. You see Dana, love immortal. Sheila, harmony in word and act. Kshanti, patience. Viraga, indifference to pleasure and to pain. Virya, dauntless energy. Dhyana, contemplation or meditation. And then Prajna, that is the other side, the andere oever, please, Dutch people. No reaction? No. The stage of consciousness where you are higher than the stage of consciousness we live in now, the other shore consciousness. Now I know it. It's not always easy to talk in another language when you give a lecture. So let us start together to look at the first jewel of wisdom and the first paramita, dana, the key of charity and love immortal. What is so special about it? What is special is not charity and it's not love in dana. It is the word immortal, that is the key term. What is love immortal? That means that that is love that is not confined to this life alone, but that is love you take with you from incarnation to incarnation to incarnation. That means that the idea of reincarnation is embedded in the idea of love immortal. And you only can understand the teachings around reincarnation deeper than only intellectually. You can do that only when you find within yourself that immortal part, that part within you that reincarnates. And that is not the, as Blavatsky says in her Key to Theosophy, it is not the personality, not the role you play in this life alone. It is in fact the actor of that role. That is the reincarnating part of you, which you are, from incarnation to incarnation. And the moment you find that part deep within yourself and you live from that part, only then you can develop love immortal. Otherwise, you will always be loving personally. Yes, and a week later you hate, and a month later you love again. That is the personal approach to loving. But your reincarnating part, what you really are, is capable of love immortal. And the moment you discover that within yourself, at the same time, your eyes and your understanding is able to recognize that same reincarnating part in the people around you, in others, in your fellow man. And from that moment on, what happens in your life? What changes? There are a few changes. In the first place, your choices and decisions in life become long-term decisions because you know that you come back next time. So you do not choose things that are only good for now, for this minute, but you try to understand if the choice you make is worthy to choose also for next incarnations to come. And what also happens in your life when you really understand reincarnation and practice dana, then you stop to discriminate because you see that skin color and education and wealth or poverty or whatever is only of the personality, but you look at the character of the inner man, of the people around you in their heart. And if you do that, and if you do that consequently, then your whole cycle of life and death, your whole cycle of dying and Kamaloka and Devachan and all those other Sanskrit terms, all those stages in that journey till you reincarnate again, the situation will change immensely when you practice dana and you understand so much more about reincarnation. And now I'm talking to you. I fear, Erika, that in 45 minutes, that will not be enough for all seven. So I explain it a little bit faster to anyone.
You can go up to 60 minutes if you wish, don't worry.
You know, I don't wish, but there are seven, and I am slave of the seventh. You know, I have to explain that as well, but I do my best. Karma. Everyone has heard of it. Everyone knows at least a little bit of it. And how many of you combined it with the Paramita Shila, the key to harmony in word and act? And realizing that only when you practice Shila, you will really understand what karma is. And you can study your whole life, the rest of your incarnation. You will never understand karma totally if you do not practice harmony in word and act. And especially for those of us who have realized that the first step is choosing for compassion, and only the paramitas are the second step. Because if you realize that, then you know that it isn't harmony in word and act at all. It is harmony in inner word and outer act. And inner word is never spoken. Inner word is what you think and speak within yourself when you promise yourself to go the path of compassion. So in fact, for those of you who have done that and who are practicing the paramitas, you know that it is harmony in inner choice and outer act. And that is much more responsible. And when you do that, you understand karma better. There are changes in your understanding of karma. The first thing that changes is that you understand that karma is not action and reaction. That is only the mechanical outer form of karma, only for people who study karma intellectually. Because action and reaction can degenerate into an eye for an eye. And that is a stage in evolution we already left behind us. We are so much further. But there is another thing that happens. The moment you practice Shila, you see that there is no good karma and bad karma anymore. when we hear in studies people talking about good karma and bad karma, I always think there is only one part of us who labels karma good or bad, and that is our personality. Our personality finds something in life good or bad, but we, in our inner reincarnating part, we see karma and we never label it. And that is a step forward. And the third thing is that you grow out of the idea of my karma and your karma. There is no my karma and your karma. There is karma. For karma is of everyone. Because karma is in fact a law of restoring harmony in the universe. And we are the universe. We are you. We are me. We are one. So when we think of that, and we in Europe say, oh, the COVID problems are better now, we forget to look at South Africa. We forget to look at Brazil and South America in general, where COVID is in the fiercest stage now. That is also we. So we cannot say, oh, COVID is better now, because we are the people in Brazil. We are the people in Africa. When in Africa, people caught COVID, there are no medicines, there are no doctors, there is nothing that can help them. And we become more responsible if we practice Shila. So, normally in a Dutch lecture, I ask now, who has questions? But your way of working is different, so I go to the third paramita. Simple. The hierarchical structure of the universe combined with the paramita kshanti, patience sweet that naught can ruffle. And everyone knows kshanti and everyone knows the teaching of hierarchies, but how many of you combine those two? And that is because hierarchical structure, people think of structuring, of putting building blocks on other building blocks. But in fact, the hierarchical structure of the universe is discovering the boundless ocean of life. The web of life, as Godfried de Brugger explains it. It is the process of emanation, where life from its heart streams other lives, and other lives, and other lives. Our living galaxy is emanating innumerable living suns. And all every of those suns are emanating living planets. And every of those planets are emanating living men. And every man is emanating living atoms and, more importantly, living thoughts. You see life within life within life within life, and it is a whole network. And if you see that web of life, then you see that this is pulsating. Inhalation, exhalation, systole, diastole, as heartbeats. And if you see that web of life, then you know kshanti has to do with that. Because kshanti is not passively being patient, but is knowing how and when things happen in nature, in that web of life, that pulsating web of energy. Because you know that when it's November, there will be no blossoms on the trees because the life stream is inward. No tantrums, just patience, knowing that you have to wait till March when the life stream is coming out again and blossoms are coming on the trees. You see that Kshanti is knowing when things have to happen. And you can call it patience. You also can call it wisdom of the habits of life in the universe. And what changes in your life then? No tantrums anymore. And the calmer you handle life's challenges, knowing when it has to come, the more capable you are to handle acceleration of karma. For that is exactly what happens when you promise yourself to go the path of compassion. You accelerate your karma. All things happen faster. The pulsation of your life is pulsating faster. And then you know why things happen, and you are never anymore in your life a victim of karma. And you see, that gives you a backbone, that gives you strength in life. You see, we can tell so much more about it, but let's go to the fourth jewel. Svabhava, self-becoming. And now it becomes a little bit difficult because however you search, you will not find that term in the secret doctrine. Self-becoming, you find in the voice of the silence, not in the secret doctrine. And Godfried de Peruyker explains why. Because svabhava is partly its definition, someone's character, someone's vibration rate. And you know, in volume 12 of the collected writings in the esoteric teachings of Blavatsky, where she says the moment you know someone's vibration rate, then you can influence that person in a negative way. So Blavatsky was very wise never to speak about it in the secret doctrine, but she did it in the voice of the silence, which she calls for the few. You know that that inscription on the first page, yes, dedicated to the few. And that means that who goes the path of compassion is able to know everything about svabhava. Svabhava, self-becoming. And who is reading the voice, ask immediately himself, which self? For if you analyze the voice of the silence, you find at least four selves. Selves with capitals, self in italic, self with all undercast, and so on. And within yourself, you can discover four selves. And in our course, Thinking Differently, we help people to find that within themselves. And it's important. And when you find that, I can tell you a little bit of it. First of all, in the beginning, I told you, you find your reincarnating self. Apart from your instrument, the personality, you find your reincarnating self. But you have more layers within you, because we all are a cosmic being. And what you find is, in fact, your inner teacher. And in theosophical terms, we can call it your inner Manasaputra, your inner basis of your thinking process. And behind and above that, you can find within yourself your inner Buddha or Christ. Yes, the mystic Buddhic term and the mystic Christian term. That is more inwards, that is higher. And then you also can find your inner God or Atman. You see three layers. You can find within yourself higher than you as reincarnating ego. And you can become all of those selves, step by step by step. And you start that process by practicing viraga. For what is viraga? V is non, out, not. And raga is the daughter of King Mara. And you all know King Mara, the tempter of Gautama the Buddha under the Bodhi tree. Mara is in fact our whole lower instrument. All our lower instincts and passions and so on. And raga is the special daughter of passion. Raga means passion. And so many theosophists misunderstood the word indifference and translated that as cool, as cold. That is not what Blavatsky meant. Blavatsky meant dispassionate, that you have grown over your passion of being attracted to something or repulsing something. Sympathy and antipathy. That is in fact viraga, grown over that. You grow over King Mara, in fact, the kama, the desire factor within yourself. And by doing that, you go nearer svabhava, your four different svas. You can come to there. And I have to say yes. In svabhava, there are two different lines in those teachings. First of all, the becoming yourself of a former life. That is the lowest reincarnating self. And you see that happening when a child is conceived. It already starts before birth. It starts in the womb, where the whole growing body is repeating, recapitulating all the different stages of evolution we already went through in former incarnations. And in fact, when you are 21, you have reached that stage that your free will, that your character is exactly on the point where you left your former life. And from that moment on, you grow further. You develop more from within yourself, with which you go nearer and nearer and nearer those higher selves within you. And that's makes me come to the fifth jewel of wisdom. And that is a very special one. Because with svabhava, already the thinker within us is emphasized. The self-consciousness, the the faculty of choice. And in evolution, that is the general term of the fifth jewel, Catherine Tingley added the word self-directed evolution. And that means that we are able, by our mind, our faculty of thinking, to give direction to our own evolution. We have in our hands the power not only to think, but to direct our thoughts, to form ideals, to determine our future. And Patanjali and others explain that by saying you become what you think. And that's exactly what happens when you practice virya, the dauntless energy that fights its way to the supernal truth. That means that you go upward, that you go in the direction of the character of those higher inner teacher, inner Buddha and inner God within yourself. And you have the power to do that because you have the power of thinking. And how can you see that in that fifth jewel of self-directed evolution? And here you find Blavatsky again in The Secret Doctrine. She has one chapter that is one of my favorite chapters, that is the three lines of evolution. And those three lines of evolution explain in The Secret Doctrine that you are a child of the earth. That at the same time, you are a child, a son of the sun. And you are also a child of the stars. And that is, in other words, the differentiation of the selves. And if you, by practicing virya, discover within yourself your earth part and your sun part and your star part, if you do that, and that is hard work to discover that, then you are able, by that power of dauntless energy, to choose to be the sun part of you, the thinking part, the inner Manasaputra, to be master over your earth part or your personality. You can do that. You have the power to do that. And later on, you can also find your inner spiritual part and let that master your middle sun part. So you see, the fifth jewel of wisdom shows you where your strengths in life are. And virya is dauntless energy. That means not passively being what you are and going higher. But dauntless energy means that you understand all the rounds and races and all those terms in the teachings of evolution, that you understand that they are not abstract things. What is a round? What is a race? Many theosophists have, how do you say that? In Holland, you say they wear down their teeth by biting on it. Yes, but the moment you see that our planet is a living entity and that we as humanity are functions in that life. We are no visitors on the planet. No, we are a function, an organ in the life of the planet. If you see that, then you see our responsibility for the mentality of humanity. We as theosophists are responsible for the mentality of humanity. So mental responsibility is much more than taking care for the plastic soup or for the ozone layer or whatever, for the climate. We are responsible for the mentality. And if you see that, then you are never anymore passive in your behaving as a theosophist. No, you stand there and you make theosophy heard and understood. For that is the only way how we can change mentality in this world, on this planet. So let's go to six. And whoever read The Voice of the Silence know the sixth jewel. Yes, you recognize it. The two paths. Oh, sorry, that is not quite good. So now there are two. Yes, the path of liberation, and that is the Prajeka path, the path for you alone, and the path of renunciation, that is the compassion path. And everyone knows that. And to really be able to choose wisely between the two, you have to practice dhyana. You have to practice inner meditation in the right sense of the word. And that means that there is a choice for you. And the key word is ceaseless contemplation. And quite a lot of us are really happy with that idea of ceaseless contemplation. But the word ceaseless must be a warning. For when you choose for ceaseless, you choose for standing apart. Apart from the pulsation of that web of life. And ceaseless, in fact, means that you fall asleep. And is that what you want when you choose for the path of compassion? I don't think so. When you choose for compassion, you choose for remaining with one foot in the tumultuous life, the outer life of the suffering humanity, and at the same time, find within yourself that point of quietness, that point of rest. But it is a combination. And you all know the Buddhist statues of bodhisattvas, you always recognize because they always have one foot on the lower ground and the rest is meditating, and that is compassion. So renunciation is in fact renouncing your ceaseless contemplation. Yes, your beautiful dream of beautiful thoughts. You're being liberated from this outer world, and you choose for partly being in, remaining in that world. And how can you recognize that in your daily life? Also, in the Voice of the Silence, Blavatsky gives us hints of how to handle your personal self. Sometimes she even says you have to kill it. And many theosophists are really, I do not want to say angry, for that is not a theosophical attitude, but they do not accept that they have to kill something that is against their conscience. But Blavatsky explains it by saying to make it, in fact, neutral, to make it, in fact, subservient to your master thinking part. Your reincarnating part is becoming master over your personality. And pitiful choice of a Prajeka Buddha or a Prajeka Chela, or how you want to call it, is the idea that you have to push away all the lower parts of yourself. You have to get rid of it just to reach Nirvana. And Dhyana, the real Dhyana, the real meditation, means that you do not push away or kill your personality, but you educate your personality. You teach your personality how to become impersonal. You see the difference? The chelas of compassion, going the path of compassion, are teachers. The chelas that who go the path of Prajeka are in fact people who only study. And we all know in the theosophical literature that Blavatsky asks us to study in order to prepare yourself to teach. And that is exactly why this lecture, to show you to study the sixth jewel, you only can do that in the light of compassion when you prepare yourself to teach. And the teaching starts with your own personality, to train your own personality to become, in the far, far, far future, when you, as a Buddha, are forced by nature to enter Nirvana, for nature is nature, there comes a point that you have to enter Nirvana. And then you have trained your personality so beautifully well that that personality reaches the level of Bodhisattva. And that is the way how a Buddha in Nirvana is able to keep in contact with our outer world through that Bodhisattva. And that is exactly what Gautama the Buddha does at the moment when all the avatars make use of the Buddha's Bodhisattva as the middle part of that avatara. So all wise messengers in the world, all founders of religions in this historic time of the fifth school class, we call it, yes, are helped by the Bodhisattva of the Buddha. And that is exactly how we have to prepare ourselves. Instead of yearning to an infinite vacation in Nirvana. Yes, because there's one aspect of having holidays. In the long term, it becomes boring. I can warn you already. So there is only one jewel to go, and that is Atma Vidya, knowledge of the self. And the seventh paramita is Prajna, the key to which makes of a man a god, creating him a Bodhisattva, son of the Dhyanis, And with every of the seven jewels, I gave you a key term. And the key term here is bodhisattva. And I hope that I explained to you that it is not written by Blavatsky creating him a Buddha. For a Buddha is forced to go into Nirvana. No, creating him a bodhisattva. A being with one foot on the ground here. So you see, prajna is in fact parajna. So beyond, in fact, what we can do as learning, as thinking beings, and it goes higher than that, but we stay a bodhisattva. And that is why I called prajna the other shore mentality. And what is atmavidya? And you all study that already, I think. It is knowledge of the self, but it is so much more than that. It is not knowledge of the self, it is becoming the self, becoming Atma. And you know, in the fourth jewel about Svabhava, becoming the self, here it is the end result that you have become your own inner God. And that means that you, as you are now, are the living example, the living atom, we can say, through which your inner God can work within this world. You are, in fact, that point of light that is the end point of a ray from your inner God to this world. And the moment you are awakened as such, then you are able to inspire others. And I don't know how you think about going the path of compassion. To me, it is always the only ideal you work for is to become able to inspire others. That is the most and only important thing to strive for in your life. And that is exactly when you practice prajna and you study atmavidya and you combine that, that is exactly what happens then. Then you are suddenly able to awaken something in someone that you think, how is it possible? That person changed totally in 1 year. And I have family members and they were in great distress. And when I was younger, I totally did not understand what I did, but I wrote people like that letters. And I wrote a letter to help them seeing the best within themselves and living from that point. People who try to commit suicide and so on. You have that great depression. You can do that. And I wrote letters. And later on, I heard, totally surprised, that people still use that letter. And that was never my intention. And that is how you and I and theosophists in general work. We develop the power to inspire, to awaken the inner power in others. Not that they listen to you or me, but that they listen to themselves, their inner selves. And that is what you learn when you study atmavidya. I think that I only have to ask you one thing. I hope it's clear that only studying the seven jewels of wisdom is not enough in life. You only develop an intellectual concept of it. And it's not enough to just practicing the seven paramitas. For if you do not know what you are doing, you are following a precept. And that is exactly the same as when someone says to you, I have a very good, a slimming diet. And you start doing that diet, and after 2 months you stop with it. Why? Because you didn't understand what you were doing. And when you combine the study and the practice, the seven jewels and the seven paramitas, you have, in fact, gold in your hand when you want to go the path of compassion. And it works. It really works. And I think, Erika, that this is a good time to ask everyone, are there questions?